But today it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Yolonda Wilson, who got her PhD from the University of South Carolina at Chapel Hill. She works on a range of topics, bioethics being one of them, social and political philosophy as well. She's done also quite a lot of an important work on race theory, and she's a leading feminist philosopher. And right now, she's a fellow at the National Humanities Center, and as well as an Encore Public Voices fellow. In the past, she's also worked at the National Institutes of Health, so she has a distinguished career, and we are really delighted that she, the first time, I believe, I'm actually 99% sure that she's speaking at the center, so I'm really delighted to have this opportunity to hear her today. And without further ado, the screen is yours.
Thank you so much. So first, I just want to thank Eduard for the invitation. It was such a pleasant surprise to receive, and thank all of you for taking time out of your lunch to come sit with me. So this is actually a work that is in progress. And so I'm currently working on a monograph on racial disparities in end-of-life care. And I have a chapter that I've entitled In Praise of Difficult Patients, where, you know, I think conceptually about what constitutes a difficult patient and how social structure and race and gender discrimination partly shape how difficult patients are conceptualized and what to do with them. But I was led to thinking about some work in empathy and talking to a few colleagues. And so I feel like maybe, I'm not sure if this will be part of that chapter or if it will just, if the ideas will just kind of be woven through this chapter, but you know, here we are. And so the talk today is Empathy and Structural Injustice in the Assessment of Patient Noncompliance. And I want to start actually with a film clip, if I can get the technology to agree, you know, so my, motto for this year is grace, right? We're in the midst of a pandemic and nothing seems to work exactly the way that we want it to work these days. And so I'm going to hopefully start here now. It's a clip that comes from John Grisham's, well, the 1996 film adaptation of John Grisham's 1989 novel, A Time to Kill. And I want us to start with the, you know, the climactic scene in the film where Matthew McConaughey as attorney Jake Brigance recounts the crime that got us here. And I can talk about that a little bit if you're not familiar with the film. We'll set up the problem a little bit more, but I want to just share the clip without giving too much away. It's just a couple minutes, so we can stop here and talk about it in a bit. Okay, here we are. Matthew McConaughey in all his glory.
I want to tell you a story. I'm going to ask you all to close your eyes. I'll tell you this story. I want you to listen to me. I want you to listen to yourselves. Go ahead. Close your eyes, please. This is a story about a little girl walking home from the grocery store one sunny afternoon. I want you to picture this little girl. Suddenly a truck races up. Two men jump out and grab her. They drag her into a nearby field. And they tie her up. Rip her clothes from her body. Now they climb on. First one, then the other. Raping her. Shattering everything innocent and pure. Vicious thrust. fog of drunken breath and sweat. When they're done, after they've killed her tiny womb, murdered any chance for her to bear children, to have life beyond her own, they decide to use it for target practice. So they start throwing full beer cans at her. They throw them so hard, it tears the flesh all the way to her bones. And they urinate on her. Now comes the hanging. They have a rope. They tie a noose. Imagine the noose pulling tight around her neck. And a sudden blinding jerk. She's pulled into the air and her feet and legs go kicking if they don't find ground. The hanging branch isn't strong enough. It snaps and she falls back to the earth. They pick her up, throw in the back of the truck, drive out to Foggy Creek Bridge, pitch her over the edge. She drops some 30 feet down to the creek bottom below. Can you see her? Raped, beaten, broken body, soaked in their urine, soaked in their semen, soaked in her blood, left to die. Can you see her? I want you to picture little girl. Now imagine she's white.
All right, so we got us there. Let me switch to my earbuds. I wanted to run out of my Mac because I wasn't sure if you could hear. So, right, we're supposed to get something out of this clip, right? Let me start with my PowerPoint. All right, so here we go. So in the 1996 film, A Time to Kill, which is an adaptation of John Grisham's 1989 novel, Matthew McConaughey stars as attorney Jake Brigance, who defends Carly Haley, played by Samuel Jackson, for killing the men who kidnapped and raped his little girl, Tanya, and left her for dead. So if you're not familiar with the film, The men are initially caught, and as they're, you know, leaving the courthouse, initially the rapists, Samuel Jackson's character kills the men. All right, so in the climactic scene of the film, McConaughey, as Brigance, delivers the closing argument where he invites those assembled to close their eyes as he recounts the details of the horrible circumstances of little Tanya's rape. That concludes with the rapists and would-be murderers throwing the child off a bridge when their attempts to hang her failed. After a dramatic pause to an all-white jury and the mostly white spectators assembled in the courtroom, Brigance tells those who have gathered Now imagine she's white. All right, so this is supposed to be the moment the viewer is waiting for, the moment when some semblance of justice will prevail through a tragedy. Set in Canton, Mississippi, the film is fraught, and some might say overwrought. I mean, if you saw McConaughey's little trembling lip, I mean, he was kind of doing a lot in that scene. But some might say overwrought with the late 20th century racial politics of the Deep South. Setting aside the understandable critiques of this film as falling prey to a white savior trope at the expense of developing the Black characters and their relationships, who the story is ostensibly about, what strikes me about the scene and has stuck with me in the almost 25 years since its release is Brigance's invitation for the audience to imagine that she's white. While imagining she's white is supposed to highlight the asymmetry and sympathy between how Black versus white crime victims and criminals are understood, it is an invitation that seems to be directed to the white audience, not necessarily in the literal sense of the white characters who comprise the courtroom audience, despite the presence of Tanya and Carl Lee's family, friends, and community, but also the white audience who is the viewer and reader, despite the fact that the actual audience wouldn't necessarily be exclusively white. Imagining she's white highlights the asymmetry for a white audience who presumably either wouldn't be aware or wouldn't otherwise care about what happened to Tanya Haley or about the death sentence that Carl Lee Haley faces as he stands on trial for what might be understood to be justifiable homicide, albeit one that is technically illegal. In other words, Haley's only hope for freedom is that a jury empathizes enough with him to engage in jury nullification, to let him off anyway. So I'm gonna give you a roadmap. So what is empathy? And what role, if any, does empathy properly occupy in our moral thinking? Right. If it seems that I'm suggesting that racial politics sometimes matter in thinking about empathy, which I am, why and how do they? So in this paper, I'll offer an account of empathy and a critique of the moral significance of empathy, most notably from Jesse Prince, before thinking specifically about the role of empathy that it plays in medicine. Finally, I'll offer a hypothetical case to show that empathy's role in health justice can be best understood in the context of structural injustice. So, and this is where I think, you know, for me at least, the audience Q&A would be incredibly helpful because I'm kind of thinking through how to conceptualize empathy in a way that captures these things that I want to capture without getting me into the kind of conceptual clarity hinterland of a paper. But I also want to kind of think about some of Prince's critiques, because I do take them very seriously, and I think he's right in a lot of ways. So what I initially was thinking would be kind of a full-throated endorsement of empathy, like, you know, Jesse, here are all the places you've gone wrong. It's turned out to be a more tentative consideration for a place of empathy in healthcare. And so I also had to, you know, just kind of lay my cards on the table here. I'm struggling with kind of competing sensibilities. So kind of philosophically and theoretically, I see a place in empathy, but then also, you know, I'm thinking about this against the backdrop of working on a book about racial disparities in end of life care specifically, and in kind of healthcare scenarios in particular. And what I find when I tell particularly Black people about what I'm working on, and certainly if the word empathy comes up, you know, a lot of times I'll hear people say, look, I don't care if my clinician exhibits any sort of empathy to me. I just want them to not be racist, right? I just want to not die when I go to the doctor. And so, you know, again, some of this is going to reflect a need to tease out what exactly we mean by empathy. But I take that line of reasoning very seriously, and I'm just trying to figure out, you know, how all the pieces will fit nicely together. So. Empathy is generally considered important because it is linked with pro-social helping behaviors. To the extent that humans are thought to be social creatures, empathy is regarded as an important component of our general well-being as humans. Empathy has come in and out of vogue among philosophers for centuries. However, to get us started, I'll use Sober and Wilson's, no relation, definition. So, according to Sober and Wilson, S empathizes with O's experience of an emotion, E, if and only if O feels E. S believes that O feels E, and this causes S to feel E for O. Now, you know, again, that's I think at this stage that might sort of be functioning more as a placeholder than a kind of deep commitment to this conception. And this is something, again, that I'll probably want to think through and work through and work out. But, you know, that's where we are for now. All right. So far, so good. O feels an emotion. S believes that O feels the emotion. And as a result of S's belief, S feels the same emotion for O. So we see that at minimum, empathy requires belief and uptake. But why does empathy require belief? So as Nancy Snow points out, because Sober and Wilson do not directly tie any causal history to S's belief that O feels E, one could land in a Gettier type problem where one feels the criteria, but would still not properly be thought to feel empathy for O. For example, S could be mistaken in their belief about O, yet still land on the right emotion. And in this kind of instance, it seems strange to suggest that S displays empathy toward O, despite the fact that S happened to display the appropriate emotion consistent with O's on emotions. S's appropriate S's appropriate emotion could be just mere coincidence. So instead, Snow proposes that empathy has to consist at least in part of feeling an emotion that is similar to the emotion that another feels because the other feels it, not simply because one believes that the other feels it, right? So Snow is trying to remove this idea of coincidence. So this addendum seems to solve the problem that Sober and Wilson's conception did not address. And for now, at least, I think it gives us a decent working conception. So empathy allows one to feel what another feels because they feel it, right? So it kind of takes the coincidence off the table. In order to do that, however, there has to be uptake from the observer in such a way that it prompts the appropriate feeling response. So without uptake, you're not going to get the necessary feeling response. The feeling aspect of empathy is what draws one to its moral significance, at least for me, at least how I'm thinking about this now. I think this might shift. And so, you know, I'd be really interested to hear kind of about how other people are thinking through this. But in that regard, empathy is both cognitive and affective. And while some argue that affect is not necessary for proper moral judgments or conduct, proponents of empathy argue that affectless performance of moral duty is in some way deficient or lacking in moral quality. So while empathy alone is not sufficient, it is a necessary component of moral beingness, right? So it's this idea that, right, empathy alone isn't going to get you very much morally speaking, but the absence of it feels kind of strange. And, you know, as I said, in working through this project, you know, when people hear what I'm working on and I end up in all these kinds of conversations about the project, just kind of lay day-to-day conversations and, you know, although on one level, people say, I don't care if my clinician feels empathy or expresses empathy or engages in behavior that one might call empathy. You know, on the other hand, I do hear people say things like, you know, this clinician just treated me or this clinician sort of behaved almost robot-like toward me. It was like they didn't care at all. And so there is this tension between certainly in communities that are used to a certain amount of disadvantage or lack of uptake, there are these kind of pragmatic concerns about, look, I just want my health concerns to be taken seriously. But there does still seem to be this need of, look, I want, there's something about the humanness or the kind of moral beingness that does seem to require at least some semblance of something that looks like fellow feeling or something. I don't know. All right. So, and one thing that I thought I would do to give a little bit more room for Q&A, I know that kind of the normal convention is to go for a full hour of talking, but I just thought I didn't imagine that a whole lot of people would want to just hear me read a paper and talk over Zoom. And so we'll probably go for about 45 minutes instead, but so we'll move through some of these ideas pretty quickly so that there's a little bit more time and space for Q&A and to break up the monotony of me just reading to you. So skepticism about empathy. And here's where I think through some of the work that Prince is doing. So meanwhile, empathy skeptics claim that empathy is not as important as its proponents think. Not only is empathy not sufficient, it is not even necessary. Notably, Jesse Prince claims that most conceptions of empathy are better characterized as concern, and that concern does not require putting oneself in another's place. In order to get the reader to what he has in mind by empathy, Prince uses Adam Smith's conception of sympathy. And so here's Adam Smith, quoted by Prince. Whatever is the passion which arises from any object in the person principally concerned, an analogous emotion springs up at the thought of his situation in the breast of every attentive spectator. Now, you know, I think there's something interesting about what Smith is doing here, or at least in Smith's description. So similarly to Snow, for Smith, empathy requires uptake, and the feeling prompted by sympathy is appropriately similar to the one that the empath observes just because the person observed feels it. Although it might feel nice to show empathy for others, Prince does not think that empathy usefully promotes ethical behavior. So, you know, again, when Prince is quoting Adam Smith's conception of sympathy, Prince says something like, look, this is more like what we mean modern day by empathy, right? So although it might feel nice to show empathy for others, Prince does not think that empathy usefully promotes ethical behavior. And he offers 8 reasons why he does not think that empathy is necessary. So I'll give you those 8. I'm not gonna have a detailed conversation about all 8 because I think 2 are most significant for the purposes of this project, but I'll give you the 8 just maybe if we wanna discuss it later. So empathy is not motivating. That's number 1. It may prompt others to feel concern, but that alone does not prompt others to step in and help. 2, empathy may lead to preferential treatment. 3, empathy may be subject to unfortunate biases. 4, empathy is easily manipulated. 5, empathy is selective. 6, empathy is prone to in-group biases. 7, empathy is sensitive to proximity effects, and 8, empathy is sensitive to salience effects. And, you know, I think, you know, again, some of these may be more relevant than others. I'm just going to focus on 2. So while I won't address the 8 considerations in turn, for the purposes of this paper, at least as it stands right now, 2 of Prince's concerns are especially relevant. 1, that empathy is not motivating, and 6, that empathy is prone to in-group biases. So first, I want to be clear that Prince doesn't think that there's no place at all for empathy, right? I mean, he's not anti-empathy, merely that it's just not necessary for the capacities that make up basic moral competence. And this is the language that he uses, right? It's not necessary for the capacities that make up basic moral competence. One can acquire moral values, make moral judgments, and act morally without empathy. So this is Prince's position. Prince is willing to acknowledge that in important ways, empathy may make us better people. And as such, it may be worth developing, right? So again, he's not anti-empathy. He doesn't think that empathy has absolutely no role at all in our moral lives, but he's just kind of thinking about, you know, how is it that we make moral judgments? And if empathy is kind of the, it can't be the be all to end all, but it's not even necessary, right? So Prince argues that empathy does not actually drive one to do the right thing. So that's the first idea, that empathy is not motivating. In other words, one can feel all the right feelings, but feeling feelings could be the beginning and end of moral action. However, empathy proponents do not claim that empathy is sufficient, only that it is necessary, right? So it's not enough, right? I don't care how many feelings you feel, right? No proponent of empathy thinks that that is sufficient, that's kind of where one starts and stops. Most moral motivations do not rely solely on one emotional state or sensibility. And perhaps only the strictest of Kantians would argue that actions of moral worth have a singular motivation, right? For the Kantian, it's going to be duty. In fact, Kant relies heavily on duty because, among other things, duty is supposedly impervious to shifts in emotion, right? So when Kant is talking about actions having moral worth, he's also aware that sometimes our emotional state can take over. And so I think, you know, this is his attempt to circumvent our emotional sensibilities, right? So, right, to some extent, Prince's characterization about empathy seems uncharitable. Yet there are plenty of people whose sensibilities about their moral duties begin and end with feeling the right feelings, right? So I spend probably more time than I should on Twitter. And this is a very common theme that you see on Twitter, right? People express all the right outrage, people express all the right joy, and then, you know, they scroll through the timeline and that's kind of it. I imagine Facebook is kind of similar. I spend a lot less time on Facebook because I'm much newer to Facebook. Twitter is probably my social media lane, but yeah, we certainly see the kind of feeling the right feelings as the beginning and end of what people are doing. So there are plenty of people whose sensibilities about their moral duties begin and end with feeling all the right feelings, but I would suggest that these people are just mistaken about their moral obligations, right? I'd also suggest that these people, you know, work that out in therapy so that the rest of us aren't just subjected to the beginning and end of their feelings, but okay. But one does not have to stretch the imagination to think of people who are truly saddened, right, by the pitiful abused kittens and puppies, but don't feel moved to donate to animal shelters, or those who express the appropriate feelings of sorrow and outrage at the latest police killing caught on film while not engaging in any sort of anti-racist action. So, you know, empathy alone isn't responsible for this. So I mean, so here I don't mean to describe those who feel guilt for not donating to the kittens or for those who aren't able to protest. I mean, as Prince means, you know, those who are satisfied with the fact that they felt the right feelings at the right time in response to the right stimuli. And again, this behavior is not unique to empathy, nor would any serious proponent of empathy claim that the puppy watcher or the police video sharer have fulfilled their moral obligation. Prince's assertion that empathy is prone to in-group biases is more interesting for my purposes, and there is good empirical evidence to suggest that Prince is correct. And so this is, I think, the part in particular that I kind of struggle with in reconciling my own inclination to be pro-empathy, right? So it turns out that although people can easily pick up others' emotions and thereby empathize with them, they are less likely to do so when that other belongs to an out-group. So even the idea of picking up others' emotions is a little bit more complex than maybe at first blush. And I know Edouard has worked on some of this kind of work. And so I would certainly love to, you know, get his brilliance and insight on this. So before I dig into this literature though, I just want to make a quick note, one that expresses my own confusion about some of the so-called empathy gap literature and highlights the need for philosophers to do this work with social scientists, particular philosophers who do race, right? So sometimes when I read through the literature, outgroup is taken to mean a group other than one that an individual is a member of. And sometimes outgroup is taken to mean disfavored social group. And the confusion is heightened by the fact that in the race empathy gap literature in particular, studies with white or almost entirely white subjects are then extrapolated to make claims about race when researchers have only really shown something about what white people do. Also, sometimes there's an equivocation in the language, right? So it's not clear to me what's meant, whether it's outgroup or just group that you are a member of. So I highlight this because other social science literature on race, particularly Josh Correll's work on shooter bias, offers a more nuanced view of how a range of research subjects understand race and racial behaviors. So if you're not familiar with the shooter bias literature, I'm sure most of the people in this room are, But, you know, I have my students sometimes engage in these first person shooter simulations around where male subjects are shown and the test taker has to decide whether to shoot. Some of the subjects who appear on screen are holding inanimate objects. Some are holding weapons, right? So Correll has developed a first-person simulation wherein the test taker has to quickly decide whether to shoot the subject who appears on screen. Some subjects are armed with weapons, others are holding harmless objects like cell phones or soda cans. The shooter bias literature, so a whole kind of cottage industry has developed around this. Actually, a lot of police do these simulations, and I'm not sure what they take away from it, but it's kind of popular in kind of cop studies, right? So the shooter bias literature shows that unarmed Black men are shot more frequently than unarmed white men, regardless of the race of the test subject. So I think that, you know, this is important nuance that gets brought into some of the literature around shooter bias that I don't always see in some of these other empathy gap specific stuff. So additionally, armed Black men are also shot more quickly, armed Black men, regardless of the race of the test subject. So in short, Black people shoot Black people too. What's interesting is that Black test subjects shoot targets more slowly and with more accuracy than others in similar conditions, but the mistakes are still statistically significant, right? So it looks like Black test takers are a little bit more accurate and exhibit less bias, but there's still kind of a pro-white bias in some of this, in the kind of shooter bias work. So what I find in the empathy gap literature is an equivocation on in-group and out-group that makes a difference in the conclusion, right? It matters how you're conceptualizing an out-group. So in other words, if one thinks of out-group as simply a member of a group that is not one's own, then it is difficult to explain the racial gaps in shooter bias literature. However, if one thinks of an out-group as a disfavored group, then the shooter bias literature is easier to interpret. Black test takers may be responding, perhaps unconsciously, to the disfavored status of Black subjects in the simulation. You know, and that kind of manifests in all sorts of ways, including stereotypes that associate Blackness with violence, right? So this matters because some proposed solutions to some of the racial disparities in healthcare include training more healthcare personnel, especially nurses and physicians, right? But if it turns out that Black healthcare providers exhibit similar behavior toward Black patients that Black test takers exhibit in first-person shooter simulations, then it seems that Prince's point is even stronger. And it also seems that we're going to have to, you know, maybe reassess just the mere fact of training more Black physicians and nurses. So anyway, so that was just kind of a little aside and a detour, some things that I think about when I read this work. But returning to the empathy gap literature, according to Gutzel and Inslet, we are less likely to catch and match the emotions and actions of an out-group versus an in-group. This is exemplified by fewer helping tendencies across race and lower values placed on the lives of the members of the out-group. In their empathy gap study, based on neural simulations, their sample consists of 30 right-handed university students recruited from an introduction to psychology class or classes, right? Yeah, without explanation, Gutzel and colleague exclude two students because they self-identified as Black and mixed race. So I was just kind of confused methodologically about kind of what further conclusions we can draw from this. So they go on to say that the purpose of their study is to investigate whether people resonate less with members of social out-groups than in-groups, and whether this bias in empathy is intensified by increasing levels of prejudice. Of course, the sample size is too small to make any significant claims. However, it is important to be clear that figuring out what white people think about in-group versus out-group does not give a lot of information about what people think about in-group versus out-group, especially if in-group and out-group are not clearly defined. So, you know, although I'm highlighting a philosophical problem with their methodology, the study design is not unique in empathy gap literature. Nevertheless, Prince's larger point that empathy can sometimes favor in-groups over out-groups seems to hold in at least some important ways. So it seems, so much works for empathy and score one for the empathy skeptic. Yet, I would argue that what we see, and maybe I'm kind of walking back from that and thinking actually what we might see, it's not a problem for empathy per se, but a problem for how empathy sometimes operates in the world, or more precisely, what we see is a problem not for empathy, but for how humans exhibit empathy. If this is true, perhaps what is needed is greater effort to cultivate empathy. So I want to just kind of move quickly to healthcare. So while there's philosophical debate about the appropriate place for empathy and moral judgment, empathy is a taken for granted good feature of healthcare moral deliberation. Roberts and colleagues note that in healthcare, empathy, hold on, let me get us to the slide. In healthcare, empathy is conceptualized as a communication competency for clinicians, an emotional bridge that facilitates helping behaviors, for example, compassionate care for patients. There's broad agreement among patients and clinicians, as well as healthcare leaders and educators, that empathy is a vital component of healthcare quality. So moreover, empathy is understood to be associated with better clinical outcomes for patients across a range of medical issues. So if Prince is correct that empathy is subject to bias, and the empathy gap literature, despite its flaws, seems to bear this out, then what does this mean for patient care? There's significant literature that Black and Latinx populations do not receive pain medications at the rate that white patients do. Among the reasons for the racial disparity in pain management are stereotypes about drug seeking, despite the fact that drug usage rates are fairly similar across race, and beliefs that Black people do not feel pain in the same way that white people do. So there's a kind of biological essentialist argument that gets made around Black people and pain management, that Black people are just fundamentally biologically different, right? And just don't experience pain in the same way. So racial disparities in pain management exist even in pediatric and end of life cases. Additionally, symptom reports of Black and Latinx patients are not addressed as quickly. I think some of this we've seen in some of the popular press around COVID testing and who's turned away and who actually gets tested, that's created some really interesting moments, right? Physicians are also quicker to amputate the limbs of Black patients than the limbs of white patients. The reasons for this are multifactorial, but it is likely that empathy plays a role in these disparities. Furthermore, as Roberts and colleagues speculate, the health disparities themselves may reflect a broad lack of empathy for non-white patients generally and low SES patients across race. In his insightful article, Fear of a Black President, Ta-Nehisi Coates opines that racism does not always manifest as animus. Rather, racism can manifest as sympathy towards some and skepticism toward others, right? I just love this Turner phrase from Coates. And I've thought about it a lot since I initially read that particular article. I think it would also be appropriate to think of racism as empathy towards some and skepticism toward others. Given how Prince's worry about empathy and in-group bias plays out in healthcare contexts, it may seem difficult to defend empathy, even as clinicians themselves hold that empathy is almost sacrosanct. According to the mythology of healthcare, and I probably get in trouble with clinicians for using that word mythology, but I think that's the appropriate word. The patient-clinician relationship is supposed to be an inviolable trust that race and SES bias should never infringe on. Yet, we know that whatever healthcare's aspirations, this inviolable trust is infringed upon more frequently than most will admit. A consequence of biased empathy is that failures of empathy can lead to less responsiveness to others' needs when those others are members of a disfavored group, not necessarily just an out-group. And biased empathy may even lead to a failure to recognize the need in the first place. And I think this is another kind of space where I'm thinking about this project, this larger project. The need simply does not register as a need. So for example, a patient who is grimacing from pain may appear to be presenting altogether different emotional or psychological state, like anger, which may invoke a fearful or angry counter response rather than a helping response, right? So if it's not registering as a need, then this is how we get these mistakes. Therefore, the inability to register pain as pain in disfavored groups not only leads to circumstances where some patients' needs, in this instance for pain management, are not met, and also the reaction to a patient's perceived need can cause further harm, right? So if you think that a patient is, exhibiting an anger response and not a pain response, then how a clinician responds to that can actually cause even more harm to the patient. So a pain response that is not afforded the appropriate uptake and is instead interpreted as anger can trigger negative emotions in a clinician, which can further erode the empathy a clinician experiences for a patient. Additionally, a clinician's response to a patient's perceived anger may go beyond the patient-clinician dyad and involve further policies and procedures of the institution, such as calling security or making a notation, right, that a patient is difficult, for example, in their medical record. So I just want to spend a little bit of time on structural injustice. That clinicians can avail themselves of the institution to codify their interpretation of a patient's behavior is one way that our health, health status, and health access are not solely the result of our or our provider's individual efforts. Instead, complex social arrangements contribute to our health or lack thereof. To the extent that empathy leads to pro-social helping tendencies and empathy can be biased against disfavored groups, social structures, norms, policies, and practices can reflect a lack of empathy toward Black patients. The outcome of this empathy bias is unjust health and health status, healthcare and health status. Unjust inequalities provide a real-world context for how health happens. Some persons are more vulnerable, more powerful, and more advantaged than others, and despite these inequities, we all experience varying degrees of interdependency. What I have in mind are these kind of structural influences. So Powers and Faden are probably the go-to thinkers about structural justice, especially as it relates to healthcare. They understand structural, and they have a book that just came out last year, I think the year before. All right, they understand structural as the fact that social arrangements, including certain institutions and social practices, have highly consequential, different, and sometimes unjust effects on individuals because they are members of identifiable social groups. So these are social arrangements. This is just a mere fact of structure. Structural injustice, to take that a step further, involves when a social structural impediment profoundly, pervasively, asymmetrically, and near inescapably diminishes an individual's most important prospects. Such impediments are often multiple and mutually reinforcing. So think back to, you know, a few minutes ago when I said the clinician can avail themselves of the institution in order to reinforce or act out their own bias, right? And sometimes these favors or disadvantages happen at the great expense of others. Moreover, these disadvantaging effects are often compounded, perpetuated, and sustained over the course of a lifetime and frequently over the course of generations. So a lot of my economist friends now are thinking, or they've been thinking for years, but I think there's more popular uptake about the role of intergenerational wealth, for example, and the impact of that on one's life chances and choices. So where does empathy fit into this picture? As I stated earlier, the fact of these gross inequities can themselves be taken as symptomatic of a lack of empathy on a structural scale. Healthcare access, social determinants of health, policies and practices of healthcare institutions, et cetera. And what makes some more vulnerable than others is the complexities of how their social positioning interacts with social structures. Additionally, formal practices like laws form a feedback loop with informal practices like social structures to reinforce structural inequalities. And so I just want to kind of quickly give you the players in a very simple case that I want to kind of use to highlight at least what I'm thinking. So here's a case. I'll start with the details and then I'll kind of think a little bit about from the doctor's standpoint, and then I'll think a little bit about patient P standpoint. So these are the two main players. So the details. Patient P has lupus and congestive heart failure, which leaves patient P chronically short of breath and battling sometimes debilitating pain and fatigue. At times, the pain is so severe that patient P cannot comb their hair or brush their teeth. Patient P sees a host of specialists in addition to their primary care physician. They and their spouse share one car and there's limited public transportation where they live. Because patient P cannot work, their spouse often works double shifts at the local factory and part-time at the local grocery store to make ends meet. Patient P's spouse does not receive health benefits through employment, so patient P does not receive health insurance through their spouse. Patient P's application to officially be declared unable to work due to disability was initially denied. Patient P and their spouse are trying to save money to hire an attorney for their appeal. The local university medical center has a special clinic through which they see patients who are poor and or uninsured. And part of the university medical center's commitment to social justice is a pledge to care for the surrounding community without regard for ability to pay, a commitment that they keep on paper at least. The couple decided to take in patient P's mother-in-law after a bad fall left the mother-in-law immobilized for 7 hours before she was found on the floor of her home. And they decided it was no longer safe for the mother-in-law to live at home. So that's kind of the background. So here are the doctors. Patient P's cardiologist, Dr. C, frustrated that patient P frequently misses appointments. And when they make their scheduled appointments, patient P is disheveled and often seems distracted. Furthermore, patient P does not take their medications consistently. And as a result, has had 4 emergency department visits in the past 6 months. 2 of those ED visits resulted in admissions. Because patient P receives their care at a major university medical center, all of the clinicians involved with patient P know one another well and regularly discuss patient P's case. Dr. C and the other clinicians all have similar experiences with patient P. They refuse to comply with the recommendations, and when they attempt to reason with patient P merely nods and promises to do better. After one particularly exasperating venting session with one another, Dr. C and colleagues collectively throw up their hands and write patient P off as difficult. After all, none of them can help patient P if patient P won't help himself. And patient P doesn't seem to appreciate the world-class care that they're getting for free. People who actually work and have insurance don't have access to the kinds of specialists who have committed their time to patient P. They contemplate dismissing patient P from their respective clinics. The patient, all right, so this is patient P's perspective. Because patient P is home and despite their own health issues, patient P is the primary caregiver for mother-in-law. It is sometimes difficult for patient P to arrange transportation to their medical appointments and care for the mother while patient P is away. Patient P's lupus leads them to be physically exhausted much of the day, some days, and the added responsibilities that come with caring for their mother-in-law leads to psychological exhaustion. The shortness of breath caused by the congestive heart failure adds to patient P's lack of energy. When patient P's spouse cannot take them to the doctor, patient P relies on a neighbor. If the neighbor cannot take them, patient P is faced with taking the bus, which adds an hour to the time away from home. On particularly bad days, the prospect of even getting out of bed is overwhelming. Patient P finds the clinicians at the University Medical Center to be short and dismissive of their symptoms. Patient P also resents being chastised by them, by the clinicians, for not taking the cost prohibitively expensive medications that they prescribe that don't make them feel any better. Patient P sees the silent judgment on Dr. C's face when patient P arrives at clinic with uncombed hair or shirt buttoned improperly. And part of patient P wishes that they could tell Dr. C what their life was like before, right? And to show Dr. C patients of how active and such they were. But patient P quickly decides that Dr. C doesn't deserve to know those parts of them. Besides, Dr. C doesn't seem to be the type who would care anyway. As patient P sits through another one of Dr. C's lectures, patient P is adding in their head the amount of time they'll have to pay for the person staying with mother-in-law while in this appointment. Meanwhile, the hard examination table on which patient P is sitting exacerbates joint pain. Patient P waits for Dr. C to take a breath, nods politely, promises to do better, and then hurries home. So what is happening? What is happening? And what role might empathy play in this scenario? No one disputes the reality or intensity of patient P's illness. The clinicians involved in patient P's case do not think that patient P is faking symptoms, yet they don't seem to appreciate how these textbook symptoms might manifest in real life. What does the tiredness that is associated with autoimmune disease like illness really look like? And how does it impact the activities of daily living? Even though Dr. C understands in theory that patient P may be too tired or joints aching too badly, to brush their hair, Dr. C still reacts negatively to seeing an unkempt patient pee in clinic. Nor are the clinicians attuned to how structural inequalities, inequities, and structural injustice shape patient P's ability to comply with physician recommendations or even to make all of their appointments. What Dr. C interprets as distraction and inattention is really patient P's worry about the cost of the visit, the time away from work that the spouse has to take in order to drive, the money that has to be paid to the person sitting with mother-in-law, the extra time away from home if they have to take the bus, the calculation of whether to spend money filling the prescription or to put something on the month's utility bill or to save for the attorney. What Dr. C and colleagues interpret as distraction, lack of appreciation, and lack of interest is really patient P's worry about making ends meet, embarrassment about their appearance, and attempts to be present despite the pain and exhaustion they are experiencing. Patient P is also frustrated by what they interpret as a lack of care from Dr. C. And in some important ways, patient P is not wrong in that frustration. One could simply assess this case as a failure of communication, and it is. One could also assess this case as a breakdown of trust between patient and clinician, and that would also be correct. However, what is also missing in this encounter is empathy. So if Roberts is correct that in healthcare, empathy is regarded as a communication competency, then there has absolutely been a breakdown in this case. And while I certainly don't mean to suggest that Dr. C is callous, I do not think that given the inherent given the inherent power asymmetry between patients and clinician, Dr. C has a special obligation to work through this failure before dismissing patient P as noncompliant. Part of the issue is that the structural injustice patient P experiences, the decisions that patient P makes as a result, and patient P's emotional responses to their circumstances do not receive appropriate uptake from Dr. C and colleagues. As I've shown, empathy requires uptake before anything else, but that sometimes other factors like bias may prevent that uptake from occurring. So returning to Snow's conception of empathy, empathy is feeling an emotion that is similar to the emotion that another feels because the other feels it, not simply because one believes that the other feels it. But in order to feel an emotion, one has to first recognize that the emotion needs to be felt, and then one must land on the right emotion for the right reasons. To be sure, it is important for clinicians to be judicious with the emotional energy that they expend. If a clinician is a puddle of emotions, then that's not good for their own well-being or for the patient's. However, what I have in mind is not required dissolving into tears at the mention of every patient's tragic circumstances. What I'm suggesting is a more minimal commitment. Dr. C knows patient P's medical history. And while it is true that there are details about patient P's life they have not shared, Dr. C has enough information to form a reasonable assessment of the challenges that patient P faces. Yet Dr. C does not seem to respond according to the information available. In addition to failing to understand the distress that patient P feels due to the structural injustices that shape daily life, Dr. C fails to pick up on or correctly interpret patient P's emotional cues. This brings me back to Prince's worry. Perhaps the average person does selectively offer empathy, and maybe who gets the benefit of being on the receiving end of that empathy is mediated by all sorts of bias or how directly one can identify with someone who is in need of empathy. Jake Regrance's appeal to the jury in A Time to Kill, imagine that she's white, picks out precisely the kind of moral inconsistency that Prince picks out in his skepticism about empathy. I've been intentionally silent about some features of Dr. C and patient P that may allow the reader to make obvious assumptions about either patient or physician, or to draw obvious conclusions, because the reality is that decisions often have to be made with incomplete information. Maybe Dr. C is a great doctor who is overtaxed. Maybe Dr. C is a curmudgeon. The story of medicine is that empathy is a necessary ingredient in making good clinicians. And so that's the part that I'm interested in. From a patient care standpoint, one could make the skeptical argument that it is better to have a physician who pays attention to the structural injustices that a patient has to navigate, thinks through to the nth degree how navigating those injustices might impact a patient's ability to be a so-called good patient, and responds accordingly via suggesting alternate arrangements or social service referrals. In other words, it might be better to have a physician who does right by patients, even in the absence of empathy. Relying on empathy to motivate a physician to do right by patients is sure to yield mixed results. And a physician who lacks appropriate empathy, if empathy grounds morality, will certainly fail to do the right thing. So I just have a few kind of tentative thoughts here. And, you know, I'd love to also kind of hear how you all are thinking. What could empathy have motivated Dr. C to do for patient P that would be different from what Prince's empathy skeptic could do for patient P? I admit that maybe the actions that an empathic Dr. C would be moved to perform on patient P's behalf might be quite similar to the actions that empathy skeptic Dr. C would be otherwise morally motivated to perform. However, there's something about the unique vulnerability that patients experience in clinician encounters that requires a different touch, even if other areas of life could function successfully without empathy. Recall that patient P senses Dr. C's judgment, and yes, senses Dr. C's lack of empathy, and it worsens an already challenging encounter. Certainly, lacking empathy does not automatically mean that one is judgmental or otherwise unkind to patients, yet patient P notices that a certain je ne sais quoi is missing from their interaction that may make patient P more comfortable disclosing sensitive but potentially relevant information. Because of this, patient P does not receive the level of care that they could receive. For all its problems, I'm not ready to give up on empathy as a necessary component of moral life, especially in healthcare. At its best, empathy enables one to capture nuance, to create a fuller, richer picture of what is happening in patients' lives. So many factors that affect health status, large-scale structural injustice, day-to-day decision-making, genetic predisposition, access to healthcare, and yes, how one is treated in the patient-clinician encounter. The ability to exhibit, the ability of a clinician to exhibit appropriate empathy with regard to each of these factors and to perform the big picture, to form the big picture, can only benefit patients. So thank you. I'll stop here.
All right. Thank you very much for this talk. One of the downsides of webinars is that we can't really clap, but I think the heart is there. So I'm going to open the floor, and I already have a few people who have volunteered to ask a question. Let me remind you how it works. If you want to ask Yolonda a question, click on Q&A and write your name there, and I will move you to the panelist status. It takes a few seconds for me to do that, so please bear with me as I'm doing it right now. And Diane, the floor is yours for the first question. Don't forget to unmute yourself. All right, thank you.
Hi there. Sorry, my Zoom just cut off for a second, but you're back. Can you see me?
Yes,
can you
hear me? I can see and hear you. Yes.
Hello. Thanks so much for this really compelling talk. And I'm particularly appreciative of the sort of the constellation of issues that you've put all together in one space here. I think that's really helpful. So I'm completely on board with the idea that failures of empathy in relation to race are playing a really big role in healthcare inequities. And I think that problem is way bigger than people realize in medicine and in bioethics. So in terms of the effort to train clinicians to recognize empathy gaps and to address them, I'm completely on board with that as a general effort. And, you know, maybe that's by far the more important thing than what I'm going to go on to talk about. I do have some concerns about encouraging greater empathy right in the realm of difficult patients, specifically, because the term difficult patient was originally developed to mean to be synonymous with a patient who has unexplained symptoms, a somatizing patient, a patient originally a hysterical patient, in other words, a female patient or a non-white patient, any patient who has symptoms that don't immediately make sense, carted off to hysteria, and there you go. So the term difficult patient really, it gets extended, but really that's what it's about in clinical training. My sense is that what's problematic in that area is the credibility gap, right? The skepticism that arises only in cases where patients don't have objective findings on tests, right? I think that what's happening in those cases is that the very problem is that clinicians are focusing on the patient's emotions and imagining that the patient is having a failure to distinguish the emotion from the bodily experience. And so the clinician in all their wisdom is going to help the patient see the difference between their emotions and their bodily sensations, right? Maybe the problem is that they are focusing too much on the patient's emotions in those credibility gap kind of cases. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I see where you're going.
In those cases, empathy, encouraging more empathy might actually lead you away from the result that you're after, which is a more serious focus on the medical duties. That's an awful lot packed into one go there. Sorry.
No, I love this. This is so awesome. Thank you so much for this question. Yeah, so even, right, the language of difficult patient has just become laden with all sorts of stuff over the years so that, yeah. I mean, none of it good, or none of it has a positive connotation, of course. But in some ways it can just become a catch-all for a patient I don't want to be bothered with. Right. I mean, sometimes there's some complications or whatever, but it can also just be this way of dismissing patients. Yeah. I think what's happening in the kind of focusing too much on emotions is, oh Lord, here I am being pro empathy for a minute. I keep switching depending on the day, is that the emotions aren't getting the appropriate uptake, right? And that's part of, right, part of the issue isn't that emotions are get uptake, it's that the emotions get appropriate uptake. And so if there's already this layer of, particularly around gender stuff and the ways that women's emotions are cashed out is just all being irrational, hysterical, whatever. Then what happens when a woman comes and says, look, I'm having these symptoms, right? Is that the clinician isn't expressing the appropriate uptake. Now, I still think that you're right. This idea of just kind of focusing on empathy without unpacking all of this background stuff can lead to exactly what you're suggesting. And so I think that maybe the prior step would be, and I don't know how to do this, right? You know, when those of us who work in this stuff, everybody always wants like the, okay, so this sounds great. So what do I do? Like, okay, do I just add another chapter in the training? Do we just take another class? But I do think that what needs to happen is a true reckoning, if you will, of how some people's emotions are processed and understood and cashed out and dismissed before you can have a conversation about having appropriate uptake. Because we know that how our emotions are regarded by others is gendered, it's classed, it's raced, it's, you know, connected to sexual orientation, it's connected to nationality. And so even the idea of thinking about emotions as these kind of abstract things that aren't mediated socially in any kind of way, I think does get you to those problems of, it's not just that we want to pay more attention to people's emotions, it's that we want to do that in the right way if we think empathy matters.
Yes, I think that's definitely right. I mean, if you could get clinicians to focus on the emotions in the right way without the biases, this would certainly be a great thing. My sense is that there's a much deeper problem in the difficult patient area, because what's happening is that instead of accepting a patient's testimony about their bodily experience as credible, they're shifting from the medical realm into the emotional realm. And that is actually the problem. Mm-hmm. If they would not ask, oh, well, how are you feeling? Does that explain your pain? Then that wouldn't draw patients out of the realm where they have clear access to care. You see what I mean? Mm-hmm. Anyway, something to think about.
That's really, I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm, yeah, because, yeah, the focus on the emotion. Yeah, right. Focus on the emotion to the exclusion of
right.
listening to
yeah.
symptom concerns.
Yeah, so yeah. you say, oh, my back hurts, my back hurts. And they look at your face and they say, okay, your face looks angry. Therefore, no pain meds for you, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. The problem there isn't that they're reading the emotion wrong.
Let me interrupt a little bit. We have about
10 yes. more. Yes, oh, I'm so sorry, yes.
I'm eager to ask a question to Yolonda. So,
okay, yes, no, sorry.
I'll suggest yes. to move on to the next question, if you don't mind.
Sure, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Denise, the floor is yours.
Thank you.
Hello. I really enjoyed your talk. And
you.
I'm going to do the thing that I...
Wait, I lost you. Okay, you're back. Okay. Now you're muted.
Can you start again? Something wrong happened. Can you start again?
You're muted too. Okay. Yeah.
Sorry. I really enjoyed your talk. Thank you. And I'm going to do the thing that I yell at other philosophers for doing, which is I'm going to say that I have a comment and then I have a question. So my comment is just actually an observation. And it's sort of tentative, but I think it seems to me that Dr. C's empathy gap doesn't only like interact with structural injustice, but it's actually constitutive of a discrete kind of structural injustice, particularly because the way that patients are characterized as non-compliant, that often gets taken up into electronic medical records, which mm-hmm. are then sort of like replicated out throughout the patient's charts, mm-hmm. like for till the end of time. And so mm-hmm. this contributes, right, to the way that other healthcare practitioners are going to perceive that patient in future encounters. And so there's this like mm-hmm. snowballing effect where mm-hmm. the empathy gap that's playing on this structural injustice is then sort of translated into a, like the beginnings of a new kind of structural injustice, because now this patient has this new sort of structure that they're interacting with every time they come and have an encounter with a physician in their healthcare system. So that was my comment. And then my question is sort of building off of the conversation you were just having with, I'm sorry, she disappeared, so now I don't know her name.
Diane O'Leary.
Which is,
I guess I'm a little bit worried about the response to sort of, you know, what should we do, right? Because, so the empathy gap points towards like the need for an individual intervention, right? Something that Dr. C can do to improve how he's perceiving and interacting with his patient. And here, I like what you said about sort of the need to reckon with the fact that our emotions and how we perceive others' emotions are sort of impacted by sort of gender and race and these other sort of structural biases that we have. But my worry is that the connection or the way that the empathy gap is fed by structural injustice points to a real limitation of individual level interventions, right? Because mm-hmm. because when what we're worried about are like social and institutional and structural problems, there's a real limit to how much work one individual sort of trying to change their behavior can do, right? Because mm-hmm. even if I change my behavior, I'm sort of interacting in these larger structures where mm-hmm. I'm probably replicating those structures and contributing to their maintenance, even when I'm, even perhaps in instances where I'm actively trying to combat them. And so I worry that there's a little bit of a tension there. And so maybe that's kind of a question, like how would you resolve the tension? Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. No, that's perfect. I mean, you know, I love your comment. I mean, this is, when I talk about how clinicians avail themselves of the institution in order to reinforce structural injustice, this is precisely the kind of thing that I have in mind, right? So a patient gets cast as difficult or non-compliant or whatever, and it you know becomes part of the medical record. And so when they walk into the door, right, the new clinician, not even the clinician, right, they walk into the door of like the medical assistant sitting at the front desk who might have a glimpse of, right, and then, oh goodness, here comes patient P. They're going to be right. So, and so that, yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. That colors the encounter. And it's one of these ways that these characterizations become institutionalized and become part of structural injustice. I don't know what to do with this tension. I mean, you know, those of us who think about this stuff, I know you've done it in your work. I don't know. I don't know. Like, the short answer is I don't know.
And, okay. Hey, Yolonda, could you solve structural injustice for us right now?
Come back at 2. I'll have an answer for you. Yeah, but I just, right, because this is a real tension. I mean, right, I mean, on one level, I could say, well, look, individuals comprise institutions. And so I don't think that that's a reason to just throw up your hands, right, and say that we shouldn't care about individual behaviors. But you're right. Often these structural stuff becomes self-perpetuating, right? You don't actually have to do anything in order for these injustices to snowball, to continue to manifest and to reflect and to grow even. So my short answer is I don't know. My longer answer is I still don't know. and even though I see the tension, I still think that we have reason to care about what individuals do, even as we try to figure out kind of the right thing to do with these larger institutions and how the institutions engage one another with structure. And I know that that's a very unsatisfying answer, and I share your worry.
All right, thank you very much. Sandy, you're next.
Thank you very much for a really interesting talk.
Thank you.
I have a question going a little different direction that has to do with what the kind of elaborated structure of motivation for acting ethically or effectively medically should be. Because it strikes me that the argument is that empathy, this effective count of empathy, I feel your pain, is clearly not sufficient or necessary for doing the right effective medical intervention, right? Mm-hmm. But in order to do the correct, the effective medical intervention, you need to know the source of the pain, whether you feel it or not. And so again, this view that maybe there's a more elaborated kind of reasoning causal structure here, that where empathy plays a role for getting at those factors in the patient's experience that expose what is medically relevant for the effective medical intervention, and that you can't really get at it if you can't understand, you know, if you're not paying attention to what the patient is saying, how they're acting, how they're looking, and in understanding the context in which those saying, acting, and looking are going to be exposing, right, what's medically relevant. So I'm curious about where this kind of process of what in these debates about is it enough for action, but well, where does it happen, this empathy? What role does it play in generating the correct response in the medical context?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No, thank you for that question. I think this is what I struggle with when I have my informal conversations with people about what I'm doing. And I don't know if some of this means that I need to kind of land on a, if I need to get greater conceptual clarity about what I mean by empathy, because I know, you know, people use that language colloquially and mean lots of different things. But, right, so when I hear Black people in particular say, I don't care if my physician exhibits empathy toward me, what I want is to not die when I'm giving birth to my child. What I want is, you know, to know that if I have a compound fracture that I, you know, that they're not going to send me home with, you know, 200 milligrams of Tylenol, that they're going to take that seriously and give me the good drugs to take care of that pain. And I, right, but I think that even thinking that way underlies a very particular conception of empathy, this idea of feeling one's feelings and thoughts and all that. And in that sense, I think, well, yeah, maybe you don't actually need that. But if by empathy you mean something much more minimal, which is almost where I think you're going, right? Just the ability to have the appropriate uptake and contextualize what's happening, then I do think you need empathy. And I think that you're absolutely right. And that's going to play a role in diagnosis. That's going to play a role in building trust, because trust becomes an important factor in having a good interaction and a good outcome. So I'm thinking that part of what I need to do is land on a clear conception in thinking about these things. But no, I think you're right. that at least in some conception of empathy, if it's just kind of being able to get the lay of the land properly, by reading cues and understanding what your patient is, where your patient is coming from, whatever that means, that's kind of fuzzy, messy language, then yeah, I do think that there's a place for empathy.
Well, one thing is your talk, and then I'll stop, but your talk, I think, I'm teaching morality and medicine to 180.
I want to sit in.
No, if you want to come and talk to them, I'll email you. Anyway, but one of the things that this helps me with is that there is this move to something called narrative medicine, mm-hmm. about what the role is. And I think there's something interesting about that approach, but narratives don't tell you what to do, but narratives give you some kind of insight in a more holistic way to the experience of the patient that is relevant for determining what to do. So I guess in some ways empathy for me seems maybe part of that approach, but that's just a comment. I don't know whether you embrace whatever this narrative approach is or.
No, I think that could be very helpful. No, I appreciate that. Okay, I hadn't thought about explicitly appealing to something like narrative medicine. So thank you. That could be really helpful.
Thank you.
Mike, the floor is yours.
Hi. I found this all immensely fascinating. I'm pretty far from this material usually, but I have a question that I think builds off of both Daniel Weber and Sandra Mitchell's questions and the discussion. So because of my own personal biases of starting point, I'm like immediately super sympathetic to there being some story where structural injustice winds up being a cause for some sort of systematic self-perpetuating or self-amplifying signaling or communication failure, which you mentioned. And because I'm so drawn to like, oh, wouldn't it be great if there's a nice, neat story we could tell of that form, I found myself back at the very beginning of your talk being much more on board with the earlier account of empathy that you said suffers from Gettier objections, mm-hmm. exactly because it could fit in so well with the communication failure type structural story. And okay. So I guess that this is a conceptual question, but I was hoping you could motivate a bit more why we want to abandon the one that could be construed as suffering these Gettier-esque problems. Because it seems like that's in fact a virtue of them when you get down the road to the structural story.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about it as a virtue. I guess for me, I was hung up on landing on the right emotion for the right reason in the right way and the right, but if we're thinking pragmatically, maybe what we care about is that stuff just goes right at the end. Does it matter how? Do I care if my physician got there because they landed on the exact right sensibility in the right way? Why does that matter to me? I think that could, I mean, I think what you're kind of pressing against is what, you know, some people I talk to get to. Like, I don't care how they get there. I care that they do the right thing. I care that they do right by me as a patient. And I think that your question is, again, pressing on that tension that I'm experiencing, even in how I'm trying to carve out this project, between, you know, the reality of these disparate outcomes, many of which are attributable to structural injustice versus these kind of things that moral philosophers at least care about in theory. I'm gonna have to think about that a bit more. That's a good way to express what the tension is, though. I like that you kind of went back to the beginning of that, of what Snow is trying to do in order to help me think about that. So I appreciate that.
I'm glad I could be helpful.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Again, it is super interesting.
Thanks, Maya. John, actually John, I probably have moved back by accident. So Louis, why don't you ask your question and then I will move John.
Sure, okay. So first of all, thank you very much. I hope you hear me well. This is, this is not necessarily a subject I think about all the time, but it's very relevant right now where I am, because in my province of Quebec, there was a case that just came out of an Indigenous woman who filmed her last moments, if you will, and like, you know, everything is there, like times 10 maybe, the racism is really terrible. And so, you know, this kind of thing sometimes strikes a chord. So I came back to read Anne Capesh, who's a Quebec Indigenous, I guess I could call her a philosopher. And she does this interesting link between, so she kind of describes a sort of school to prison pipeline that's like a way of imposing, a way of colonization, a way of imposing a new culture on her people. And she makes this interesting link where the very last point in this pipeline is the hospital. And mm-hmm. the link there is about how the hospital is, this is a bit my interpretation, because she speaks maybe for an Indigenous audience who understands stuff that maybe we don't. But the hospital is a bit of the way that the colonizer justifies their presence there. You know, we're bringing you all this good stuff that's including good care. And good care is like the ultimate gift, if you will. Like we're so nice, we're taking you in, we're treating you for free. Mm-hmm. And so my impression is that this is very similar to what the case that you were mentioning. Dr. C thinks, well, you know, we're giving this patient the very best care in the world. How come she's mm-hmm. not thankful for it? Mm-hmm. And the thing is, well, why is she in the state that she is? It's because of the oppression that's put on her, the economic oppression that's put on her. And the fact that he doesn't make this link and just takes this act of as giving is maybe the heart of the problem there. Mm-hmm. I get the impression that empathy is more of a symptom than a cause. Well, at least mm-hmm. if you take this perspective. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's any useful, but like, it seems to me that when you're resisting empathy, in part, there might be something that, you know, it's not all about empathy. Like if you have the system that construes care as a gift, as a generosity, actually, to patients, well, it's gonna entail both lack of empathy and maybe suboptimal treatment. I get the impression that maybe like, if you just, you have a system like that, you ask people to be more empathic in certain ways, well, maybe but you're still putting it as a generosity, like that wouldn't really solve all the problems. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense? Is it?
No, this is great. Just take this last note. Yeah, I mean, I think that this is great. And I think that part of one thing that your question brings out is the complexity here and just how structural injustice manifests at multiple levels, right? So, you know, maybe depending on what we know about patient P's background or about the Indigenous woman in your case, part of the issue of the health problems in the first place, at least some of them, maybe you may be able to draw a direct link between structural injustice that's been experienced over the lifetime, or even if you're going to think structural injustice kind of bigger over the course of generations that just kind of grows exponentially and doesn't increase. The other thing that you said about thinking about this as a generosity, and I'm glad that you picked up on, you know, how Dr. C and colleagues say, you know, we're doing this thing for patient P, right? So there is a sense of do-gooderism that is getting in the way of even seeing patient P as equal and as having certain autonomy or having certain room for expectation of a particular kind of treatment, right? So if you're getting something out of charity, then the idea that Dr. C is implicitly suggesting is that patient P ought to just be grateful for that and just ought to do whatever is an expression of that gratitude. And so that's a kind of lack of empathy in a different way than I've brought out in the paper. And so what I like about your question is you're showing for me, or giving me kind of ways to think about teasing out much more explicitly how complicated structural injustice is, but also how complicated empathy can be, because there are lots of different manifestations of what's happening with empathy here. And you are right that empathy isn't the whole story, but it's coming in at different levels of the story. Yeah, so thank you. I remember reading about the case that you're referring to in Quebec.
Okay.
Yeah, right. So I should perhaps look at that. That might be helpful for me.
I can send you the name, I think Joyce something, but I'll put it in the maybe Q&R.
Oh, I appreciate that. I appreciate that.
Okay, we are supposed to be ending now, but we'll take a couple of quick questions and quick answers, just because some people have been waiting to talk to you, Yolonda. If you could keep it short, that would be appreciated. Alison, you're the next one.
Hi, thank you. I loved your talk, Yolonda, and I thought the movie clip was a really great way to start it out. It was very moving to me, and I'm going to have to steal that from you to try to motivate with my med student. And I really liked how you connected it in the case with Dr. C and patient P about how one big issue there is that even though the physician knows everything about the disease, they fail to appreciate how it's impacting this patient's life. And I thought that was a really great connection. At the same time, though, I kind of wonder if part of the problem, at least in that case, is that the doctor is imagining that the patient is white. So they're thinking about, like, how would a white patient with lupus behave when she came in here? And it's not what this particular patient would be going through. And so it just made me think about the complexity of the issue, because I'm not sure that, I mean, maybe a purely empathetic person or like a really good, really well empathizing person wouldn't just be thinking like, what would I do if I were in their shoes or something? Mm-hmm. But it made me wonder about maybe auxiliary character traits or virtues or skills or something that go hand in hand with empathy. And I think that the narrative medicine conversation is maybe one auxiliary issue, but maybe also something like curiosity or humility or something like that. And I was wondering if, as you explore empathy in healthcare, if you've sort of run into these nearby ideas as a way of kind of enriching how it works.
Yeah. So about the little, you know, kind of rudimentary case, I didn't actually, I was intentional about not giving racial details about either the physician or the patient. And I was trying not to give gender details, although I did slip and call patient P she once, for those of you who are astute listeners. And I was doing that. And I, you know, again, I don't know if I was being too cutesy in the form of a talk, but part of what I was doing was hearkening back to McConaughey. So thank you for picking up on that. I don't know, again, if it came out a little too cutesy, because then does it make the scenario more complicated or less complicated that I was intentional about not giving certain kinds of identifying details that would lead one to draw conclusions. But I do think you're right. That right, how physicians imagine patients is often wrapped up in some notion of an idealized patient, whatever that patient may be. Maybe it would be a white patient, a white male middle class patient, or you know, whatever. Add your identifying characteristics, and that. So some of the judgment comes out at not being that. And that's interesting to me, but it also is why I think I find Coates's characterization of racism in particular, and I think that we can think about structural injustice like this more broadly, as being broad sympathy towards some and broad skepticism toward others. I think that's what you're getting at, Allison, this idea of, you know, how do I interpret what it is a patient does when a patient isn't doing what I think they should be doing? Is it easier for me to make sense of the choices that patients do have, you know, in within their purview? And am I more sympathetic toward some patients as a result of those choices because of how I'm interpreting sympathy and skepticism? I think that's really helpful. Thank you. Yes, I do think, you know, things like curiosity and humility could certainly work with empathy. I know that when med students in particular take these courses, they teach all of these things together.
I thought of curiosity in particular because I wondered if some of the limits of empathy are due to limits of awareness or knowledge. You tend to interpret people's behaviors through the framework of your own experiences, or at least the ones you're familiar with. And you, mm-hmm. I mean, everybody has limited experiences. Mm-hmm. I didn't just mean to pick like a random virtue or something, but
yeah, no.
As informing our ability to be empathetic, sort of being curious about the situations people are actually in.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. Yeah, that's a nice way to think about, moving from the textbook to how that actually looks.
All right, let me interrupt a bit this exchange since we're already way above time. Peter Stockinson, do you have a short, really short question for Yolanda? Peter?
Yes, I think so.
All right, go ahead.
Oh, let me see. Thank you for the bringing up this topic. We're dealing a lot with healthcare these days, so it's just right on the money. And what comes to mind is that what I see missing is that why do patients and medical professions come together in that encounter? Mm-hmm. Are we on the definition of, are we on the same page? Are our goals the same? Because putting a patient as difficult, non-compliant implies that there is responsibility and failure on the side of the patient to do the right things. While in education, the ethos is different, is when a student fails, it's teacher's failure to communicate or take care of the student properly, not getting to the student in a way that it's accessible to the student and helps him to learn. So they're opposite, values here or goals. But when we go to a doctor, what I want, I don't care, like you said, some of the people, I don't care whether he has empathy or not. Mm-hmm. I do care that he is looking through a system. So I like the doctors that look at the symptoms view of the patient treatment.
Exactly.
But all the factors that come in to make a case, and they come in to as a result of such whatever is the complaint, physical or emotional. But I do want them to also recognize, do we have an agreement? Are we working toward the same goal? Do we work like and make a contract with a patient? We have a disease that is incurable. So we're dealing with the doctors that can be limitedly in a limited way to help, but we have an agreement with, okay, so are we okay to work on having to slow down the disease? Yes. Then we know what we're working toward together, that I am responsible for my part, they're responsible for their toward the same goal. And I don't see that arrangement here. It's like, why would lack of definition, that why would doctor see the patient and then here is poorly behavior, misbehaving patient. I think if we don't have why they come together, then the whole relationship falls apart. Another thing that comes to mind is that there is a power uneven, you already mentioned that there is uneven power relation between patient and a doctor. I mean, one could say that yes, the patient has autonomy to just not come, but that's not going to solve the problem. If they want to solve their problem, they need a doctor. And so the doctor is empowered, the patient is disempowered because they want something. And I don't think this can be ever overlooked or not mentioned, that by definition, by the meeting, we have an uneven situation. Plus you get a racial, educational, because education matters. They say, oh, Pablo,
yeah, absolutely,
you're a doctor. That's nice to meet you. That shouldn't matter. Yeah. That shouldn't matter. And so those factors also, not only systematically, but also on a psychological level, there are those biases that are inherent and not always made explicit, or we're not aware of them. So you've got a lot of, this relationship has a lot of complications. I think that's basically, yes. I would look at the systems, I would throw away empathy, because all I want them is have a procedure that they do are competent and look at the factors that confound my case.
So you're on the, I don't care if they have empathy page, because these other things matter more. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, I understand.
There are people who have no empathy. Like psychopaths, but they act beautifully to navigate through the world and get their goals met. So do they need to have it? No, they need to know how to express it in a way that will make their goals, to achieve their goals. They are brilliant at that. Cold killers. But so there is a question of having empathy, but also what is the right expression of it?
Okay. Yeah. Oh, I like that. And you're bringing out a different, an additional tension, right? Having and expressing.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I like that.
This relationship ain't easy. What I'm coming from is from symbolic interactionism, that views that there is a code of behavior or expectations from how the doctor behaves. And there is, we kind of have it in our hands, it's a sentiment. And also we have some form of understanding how a patient behaves. And that defines that non-compliance. That makes a patient, it's not really adhering or meeting that my norm, my expectation of the proper behavior and what is the proper patient. What if I come dirty too? Because I didn't have time to clean myself from coming from work and I'm doing dirt work. And that disqualifies me essentially to a large degree as a proper patient behavior.
Let me interrupt you. We are already way above time. We're actually 50 minutes above time. So
I appreciate that you let me speak.
No, I appreciate. Thank you.
I think it was a great opportunity to have some more discussion. Many people wanted to talk to Yolonda, so for many people to exchange with her. I'd like to thank all of you. I think we really must stop here for today. And mostly I'd like to thank Yolonda for her wonderful talk today. I don't have an opportunity to ask my questions. It will be for our next meeting, hopefully not in 10 years.
And that's right.
And in the real world, hopefully. So thank you very much, Yolonda. I think on behalf of the center and all the attendees, this has been a really wonderful talk, as you've seen by the Q&A. We're really excited. Thanks.
Thank you for everyone for coming. I mean, I'm so blown away by the questions. All of them were really helpful and your attention. So I just appreciate all of you. And thank you again, Edward.